Okay.
Okay, I'm gonna skip it to the next video now because I'm looking at my timer. I'm gonna talk about, I don't know if Lauren Southern shared what the topic is for tonight's conversation, so I actually won't share it. But it has to do with this kind of stuff, and so I think it'll be really interesting to see what happens. I hope I can contribute something to the conversation. No promises. Okay. This is called In Defense of Jerry. It's a video essay.
What?
This video is about Jerry. More specifically, this video is about what it means to be a Jerry and why people hate him. But before we go into any of that, I need to tell you about the meme that started this whole train of thought. It's gonna take about 30 seconds, but stay with me. So recently I was scrolling through Rick and Morty fan pages as one does, and I found this horrible post that didn't make any sense. Listen, I'm not gonna
What did the Twin Towers and genders have in common? Oh my god, I cannot read this script. There used to be two, and now it's too offensive to talk about. Okay, that's funny. I laugh at everything, but that's okay.
Pack what's going on here. That's not what this video is about. But if you think the picture was okay, then I can assure you this video is not for you. I'm not bringing up the meme because of the insensitive message.
Wait, the joke was funny. Wait, it wasn't even that bad.
But if-
Wait, it wasn't even that bad. What do the Twin Towers and genders have in common? There used to be two, and now it's too offensive to talk about. That's fucking funny! What are you talking about? That's literally a fact. That is what is happening in those bubbles. What?
Listen, I'm not gonna unpack what's going on here. That's not what this video is about. But if you think the picture was okay, then I can assure you this video is not for you. I'm not bringing up the meme because of the insensitive message. I'm bringing it up because of the comments. All commenters seem to agree with it except for one guy who correctly asserted that there were always more than two genders, that these statements were not equivalent, Rick would never say this, and again, it was just generally shitty. Good on him! But what-
What? That is not don't fucking play with me. That is not offensive. What bubble is offended by that? There was a tower. So is the offense the part that there was always two genders? Y'all are pussies, bro.
What was so shocking is how monstrous people were to him. They were calling him too sensitive, a sheep, stupid, and get this, a Jerry. The scary thing is, this-
Okay, y'all know I think Jerry's a one. Y'all know I think ones are useless. Y'all know, in order to be a one, you have to be useless to yourself and your community at the same time. You also know I think ones are redeemable. You also know I don't think you should genocide the ones, okay? But if this person is about to go on a tirade to defend Jerry, it coincides with the joke. Oh my god, this is so funny.
This type of attack isn't isolated to this post. Jerry hate posts and using him as the butt of an insult is common practice on the show's forums.
By the way, I love Jerry. He's my most lovable one. It's why I think we shouldn't kill the ones, because Jerry is so lovable. Why would you kill Jerry?
But why? What does it mean to be a Jerry, and why is it a bad thing? On the surface, people have associated Jerry with being weak, afraid, insecure, overly sensitive.
Literally.
When I asked why series fans didn't like him, one person mentioned that he was a cuck, which says more about the commenter than Jerry, but whatever. People often cited Rick's speech after Jerry reluctantly tried to kill him on the whirly-dirly to explain their hatred.
You act like prey, but you're a predator. You use pity to lure in your victims. It's how you survive.
But the thing is, besides the cuck comment, I don't necessarily disagree with them. I too blindly believed that Jerry was a loser based on the forum's discourse. I mean, Jerry's hands aren't exactly clean when you look at moments like this.
Open the door! Open the door!
There isn't time! Just run!
But then I rewatched the series with more critical eyes. I was absolutely-
Jerry is so great! Don't try to redeem him. You don't have to. He's redeemable because he's so great being Jerry, a one.
Stunned when in the first 10 minutes of the first episode, this happened.
Have you not been getting the messages I've been leaving with Morty's grandfather?
Boom! Told you! In your face! He is ruining our child!
Wait, what am I celebrating?
He stopped bragging about being right that Rick was a bad influence on Morty because he knew it wasn't important who was right. Their son's welfare was what was important. That's when I realized that the negative examples people gave don't represent Jerry as a whole. If you look at Jerry fully, you can see he's an extremely nuanced character when the writers want him to be. He's caring, rises to occasions, owns his mistakes, and takes chances on people and ideas he believes in. Even when everyone is blatantly and unjustifiably against him. Like in the episode when Jerry becomes a Plutonian hero for saying Pluto was a planet and almost destroyed the planet with a political conspiracy because they stroked his ego. Within the episode, he admitted he was wrong and selfish. Rick would never do that. In Rick's speech after the whirly-dirly, everyone loves to quote the ending of what he says.
And you survive because people think, oh, this poor piece of shit, he never gets a break. I can't stand the deafening silent wails of his wilting soul. I guess I'll hire him or marry him.
But that's not true. If you watch the Interdimensional Cable episode, you realize that Jerry's family and Beth might actually be bringing him down. Sure, in the alternate reality, both Beth and Jerry are lonely and miserable without each other, but Jerry is a respected and critically acclaimed Oscar winner. It showed that Jerry had potential to do great things outside of having a kid with Beth out of wedlock. So
again, he's weak and a bottom, and that's why he stays in his shitty life instead of leaving it and being great. Because he's not grown up enough, brave enough to face himself and his choices. Jerry chooses to stay. He's useless to himself. He's useless to his community. Jerry has created such a loophole of an existence by consenting to this marriage in his life, by not leaving, that he literally allows himself to be, like, his community doesn't need him. So he's useless to them, and he can't help himself enough to get out of it, so he's useless to himself. He's a one. He's a lovable one.
So in associating being a Jerry with someone who is sensitive and emotionally open, the toxic side of the fan group is inadvertently acknowledging the more admirable parts of the character. So why then is being a Jerry a bad thing? Why do people demonize him for his faults, but give someone like Rick, who is equally insecure and flawed, a pass? Why?
Because Rick isn't pathetic. Rick is an asshole. It's not the same. There is a type of way a person can be that is, like, it's so self-pitying that it's disgusting. And that's Jerry. Even though we love him, Jerry just, he's so, like, Rick's self-pitying in a completely different way, in a tolerable way, because Rick does things. Rick still gets his shit done. Jerry can't do shit. Jerry just self-wallows and then blames everyone else. And then people like you come in and go, yeah, Jerry, you're right. You are the abuse victim. Maybe. But he's still the arbiter of his life. He's still, you know what I mean? Like, he's like, if it's a spectrum, because Discord is saying Rick is also a little pathetic, for sure. But it's different. It's a different, it's just a different kind. Like, you know how Bobby Lee is a form of pathetic and Ethan's a form of pathetic? But then so is, what's his name? Everyone's a little pathetic, but it's a different specific way. You know what I mean? Someone said Rick is a asshole, but he's a capable asshole. That's what it is. Rick is the least capable, which means he's more reliable than a Jerry who's not even capable. So he's not even, there's not even a chance of him being reliable.
Why do people hate Jerry? Well, today I'm gonna defend Jerry while exploring what disliking him says about our insecurities. But before we get into the defense, hi, I am not Emo Parker, I'm Ariana Alexis. For some of you longtime fans, I just got a haircut, I'm getting used to it, so we're gonna deal with that through the video. But in the meantime, I'd like to let you know that I did not misspell defense in the title. In Canada, where I'm from, defense is spelt with a C and not an S. So please be aware of that as you furiously go to type that I spelt it wrong. All right, now to the video. Right off the bat, I think people don't like Jerry because he reminds them of themselves. Which is funny, because that's also why some people like him. Jerry is normal. Jerry has a normal job, and when he doesn't, he has a hard time finding a new one. He has normal, mundane interests with normal, non-sci-fi problems. He's scared of the unknown, is insecure about his place in his family, is vocal about his insecurities, and finds meaning in his life through his family.
Someone said this to me when I went after Jerry. Someone kept saying that Jerry's a normal person. I don't know what kind of normal people you hanging out with, but my normal people are not like Jerry. So my whole bubble, there was not a lot of Jerry's. Like, not a lot.
Family. In the context of the show, he's a depressing reminder of all that the series demographic lives with. The main demographic for Rick and Morty being millennials. Hello. Millennials are, in essence, the Jerrys of the generations.
What?
As one paper out of California Polytechnic State University about the humor of Rick and Morty states, millennials have grown up in a world that promises them everything but failed to deliver. Growing up, we saw examples of people finding and marrying their spouses young, affording a house, and easily afterwards finding fulfilling full-time employment right out of school. We, the children of these people, assumed that we would have the same things in the same time frame our parents did. But, unfortunately, time makes fools.
My parents couldn't buy a house till they were in their 40s. I'm gonna buy the house. My house probably before them, which means I will have had a house before my parents. But I come from an immigrant background. You know what I mean? Like, their story is probably true, as is my story. So I feel like this is probably just like a bubbles thing, but let's check out this bubble and see how we feel about it.
Fools of us all. Or rather, time makes fools of people born between 1981 and 1996. According to a 2014 Pew Research study, millennials, in comparison to previous generations, are the most educated yet experience the highest levels of unemployment, have the highest level of debt with the lowest...
Yeah, I'm a millennial that did the opposite. I didn't go to college and I make more than my college friends. Some of them, depending on what they did with their degrees. But that's a bubble thing, right? So this is, what bubble is, would you guys, this to me is not the majority. The majority to me is like blue collar workers and people who couldn't afford to send their kids to college. Their kids had to go on loans and maybe their kids finished. But my bubble was mostly like trade school. But I had some people, like the friends of mine who went to college and their parents paid for it were like, whoa, you have like rich parents, basically. So this is like, is this the general majority in America, would you say? Because I feel like this is just like rich people or like people who have one kid, not like the people I grew up with, you know, but it's cool.
Most amount of personal income or wealth, are less likely to own a home based on the skyrocketing real estate market, are less likely to get married despite wanting to because we lack a solid economic foundation to go through with it if we do find someone, experience the high.
Do we want to get married? Most of my millennial friends do not want to get married. I don't even care about marriage. I'm just doing it for the legal doctor visits.
Highest rates of loneliness with the least amount of reported personal friends. And are the most mistrusting of other people and social institutions. We might be the worst off generation in comparison to the past, but damn we want to be happy. That Pew Research survey also found millennials were the most hopeful generation despite our realities not matching our expectations. It's a weird mixture of not having the life you thought you'd have, being hopeful about eventually getting that life, but constantly falling short. It's not a pleasant feeling, a 28-year-old millennial who still lives with their parents says. But Rick and Morty helps us feel better about our situations by mocking aspects of society that have let us down. Rick diminishes the value of education, personal possessions, government, love, human connection.
What people call love is just a chemical reaction that compels animals to breed. It hits hard, Morty, then it slowly fades.
Instead, he tells us that nothing means anything and caring about things is stupid because the world's just fucked.
There is no God, Summer. Gotta rip that band-aid off now, you'll thank me later.
As the Cal Poly paper states, the absurdist humor of Rick and Morty provides the millennial generation with a much-needed trivialization of all the stressful facts in their lives, instead of endlessly trying to find meaning in it all.
YouTube. Where's the comment? I lost you. Oh, you said most of the people in your bubble want to get married, see? So most of the people in my bubble do not even want to get married. When I say, okay, let me rephrase. I want a wedding, like I want a barbecue ceremony to be like, we're together. I wouldn't need the legal documentation unless there was like a huge benefit, and there is a huge benefit. Like you need to get married in the States, like, or you need to get married where you are so you can have like benefits, right? But I just want, like, I don't even want a wedding. I don't even want to walk down an aisle or anything. I just want to have like a barbecue and be like, yo, we're together. This is officially our statement to the public. It's like a more of like a hand fasting. It's more of us making like a declaration in front of friends and family. You know what I mean? But is that the same as, like, wanting to get married, I guess? Maybe everyone wants to feel important to everyone, and we want to do the thing that makes us feel like, oh, now we're important to you. And we want to symbolize that to the world. And that's why we wear rings and all these things. So maybe that's it, and we all do want to get married, even when we say we don't.
Rick and Morty's philosophy encourages disenchanted youth to respond to which they cannot change with irony, laughter, and a sense of absurdity. On the other hand, Jerry embodies the millennial reality, dashed hopes and all. He strives for the regular things he wants, but the other characters call him lame for trying to be happy and enjoying his life. As Dan Harmon pointed out,
Jerry wants to be a good father. He wants to be macho, he wants to be rich, he wants to be a provider, totally. And keeps being told by the universe Rick represents that that's a stupid goal. That will always fail, because trying it means you've already failed.
However, Rick makes us feel better for not having our shit together. He reassures us that as soon as we put ourselves out there, we're doomed. So it's not our fault things don't work out, it's just what happens. Jerry inadvertently makes us feel bad because, like him, we try but we're terrified of being the loser everyone thinks he is.
We will have as much fun as possible on our Titanic-themed getaway.
Let's lose the tood, please.
But you know what? Depending on your bubble, I think Jerry's lame. But in some other bubble, he's great. But I love Jerry. But yeah, I don't want to go on some Titanic fucking whatever. And Rick's family is not the average American family. Like, Rick and his kid, well, his kid, his daughter, and then her kids, even though they're Jerry's kids, they're really her kids because they're grumpy like her. They're that kind of family. So it's just a mismatch. It's Jerry's personality, which would thrive in a different environment with them and their personality. But I'm somewhere in the middle. I want less of Jerry and less of them, and I want in the middle. Because I'm not soft like Jerry, and nor is my bubble. And my bubble isn't like that. We're not assholes like Rick and everybody else. So who are those people? Because I think that's the majority of the world. I think the majority of the world are not Jerry's, and they're not Rick. I think the majority of the world is in the middle. Because most people are really fucking good, and they're nice. And I go to Walmart all the time and no one fucking stabs me randomly. You know what I mean? Like, some people have those experiences because they live in those bubbles. But are the majority of us living in bubbles where we're getting stabbed every day? I don't think so. Jerry just is a very specific kind of human. And yeah, if I was around Jerry or Rick for too long, I'd get really fucking pissed.
Please, it's supposed to be romantic.
But I love them and I wish them the best.
Romantic.
Speaking of disasters, Dad.
But Jerry isn't a loser. Rick and everyone else may say he is, but they have a low threshold for what that word means as shown by the Jerry Barry. Rick, or whatever Rick built it, did it to keep Jerry safe and patronize him. The caretakers talk baby talk.
Did you come here in a space?
He needs it. I will not allow this to, okay. It's like Sneeko and Andrew Tate and everyone else. It's the same thing. People treat you according to how you let them treat you and what you signal for them to treat you as. Jerry is being treated the way Jerry wants to be treated.
The Jerrys get to
romp and play with other Jerrys.
Their activities are watching directors come.
It's both. If they're enabling Jerry because no one wants to invest in Jerry because no one invests in themselves. It's true that Jerry has more potential, but Jerry is not living his potential. So it is true that in a different environment, Jerry could be a great person, but it's not. He doesn't want to be. It's his choice. And then they don't want to be. Rick doesn't want to help him. His daughter doesn't want to help him. They're like giving up. Though later in the seasons, he did get better. He became a two, I think. He like went from a one to a two, and that was really interesting. And his, what's her name, guys? What's the mom's name? Beth. And then Beth, you know, she really tried with Jerry later in the series. So I'm curious on how they'll take this season, you know, how the next season will go. But Jerry here, especially in this infantilization episode, hello, ma'am. Jerry wants to be treated this way.
Commentaries and getting to pick the TV settings. And there's a giant Beth mascot that's nice to them.
I love you, Jerry.
Aww.
The way it's framed implies it's a sad experience for a sad person. But if you look at the core of the Jerry Barry,
it's also a sweet event for, they give Jerry, he's happy.
You can see that it's just a role play for regular human comforts. An updated version of the life that Jerry already lives, where he gets to make decisions, have friends that understand him, and the love and respect of the people he loves. All of that isn't sad. What's sad is he has to go to an amusement park to get it. Yet, most of the characters in the show and the audience insult him for his simplicity. These are the things everyone wants in their lives. Love, a modicum of respect, control, which again, most of us are statistically lacking. Yet we mock him and pretend we're all Ricks. Not because Jerry's worth mocking and we're all toxic geniuses, but because by pretending we're better, we get to pretend that we're not Jerry's. The moments that best show this is in the episode
Speak for yourself.
titled The ABCs of Beth. In separate scenes, both Rick and Jerry give justifications for why they're not bad people. Rick threw Beth, but the point remains.
I'm not an evil person. I'm lazy, I'm cowardly, and I do not know what I'm doing.
Am I evil?
Worse, you're smart. When you know nothing matters, the universe is yours. And I've never met a universe that was into it.
We would rather believe we're evil or unhappy because we're hyper smart and nothing matters, rather than admit we have something fundamentally wrong with us and are liable for ourselves. Jerry isn't stupid, despite what everyone says. Sure, he's not the smartest crayon in the shed, but he has an emotional intelligence that Rick and almost everyone else in the series besides maybe Morty lacks. In seasons 4 and 5, the most recent seasons as of making this video, Rick has displayed more emotional intelligence, but Jerry has surpassed him through the entire series.
Discord says, no, what is sad is that he's happy with a fake delusion.
For example.
Yeah, I think what's sad is that he stays. Like, that, you know what I mean?
Pluto is...
Yeah, Bryson says, I'm not a Jerry, nor am I a Rick. Exactly. Like, that's also true. Like, gosh, honestly, no one in that show is redeemable. Like, well, they're redeemable. Let me rephrase. No one in that show is, like, a good person, but they're not bad people. They are good people. But they're not people that, like, I am glad I don't really identify with anyone in that show. And at the same time, there are parts of me that exist in all of them, for sure. But there's not, like, a character in Rick and Morty that I'm like, I'm Rick. Like, I'm not Rick. Rick and Morty, by the way, reminds me of, like, Seinfeld or Will and Grace. You know, those people were not good people, right? Like, Seinfeld, they're not great people. Like, they're okay, but, like, they're not great. And then in Will and Grace... Bro, Will and Grace is violently bad. Like, they're bad, but they're good. In the new reboot of Will and Grace, they think they kill someone and then use his fingerprint to approve a job application so they can get a job because he was going to approve it anyways. They thought he died. And they, like, do you know what I'm saying? Like, there's, these shows are not meant to represent, I think, people that are good. I think the fact that we like Rick is also a reflection of how we see ourselves. Like, this obnoxious, alcoholic asshole. If you... Yes, so this is what's happening. There's the people who identify more with the Ricks and the people who identify the most with the Jerrys. So this human making this video obviously relates to Jerrys. I would say I relate more to Rick, obviously, because I've gone through those journeys of being, like, nihilistic. I'm not like Jerry, obviously. But, ooh, TMM says he's totally a Morty. Then there's the Mortys and the Summers and the Beths. These are all different kinds of people. I'm definitely probably Beth than Rick. Probably. Competitive and neurotic.
Not a planet.
It's not a planet! I'm an idiot! I love my son!
This doesn't mean that Jerry doesn't fuck up, but he takes responsibility for his shortcomings. The idea that Rick unnecessarily insults Jerry for his vulnerability can also be seen in how all other Ricks hate Doofus Rick. Doofus Rick isn't an idiot and...
I don't eat poop!
He's just as intelligent as his interdimensional counterparts, but he has an emotional intelligence that the others lack, and
for sure, 100%. It's not a competition. Rick also needs to change. That show is about people who need to change. That whole show, everyone in the show has to change. Rick is not the hero of the show. Rick is a gross alcoholic who burps and it bugs me. But he's also Rick and he's lovable. Jerry's lovable too, though. I think they're all lovable.
And see as a weakness.
Do people watch Rick and Morty and think there's, like, a winner? Of course they do.
When it's not really.
You know, Jerry, I'm not going to tell you that these will increase in value or even hold their current value.
Discord, don't ask me hard questions. Is the moon a planet?
Truth is, you bought them because you like them. They have value to you. That's what matters.
Emotional maturity is equal to or more important than intelligence. Rick is not the role model many audience members think he is. Again, he's deeply broken. The only reason he...
Bro, if you think Rick is a role model, you're broken. But if you think Jerry's a role model, you're also broken!
Thinks nothing matters is because something was taken from him. And it was more painful to deal with it than to believe that the world is shit and just keep going. Instead, he hides his sadness behind drinking and abusing people he loves. On the other hand, when Jerry thought his family was pulling away, he made mistakes and grew from them faster than Rick ever did. I know it's hard to compare their stories since Rick's family was murdered and Jerry was only going through a divorce, but the general idea is the same. Jerry dealt with his pain better than Rick. Jerry understands if he's unhappy, it's his fault, and works to improve himself.
Bryson says they're all deeply flawed and lovable, and I like that message. Me too. I think that's, guys, that is why I literally, I wish I could see everyone so I could have this kind of tolerance towards everyone, but I don't, which is why I think it's okay to say, like, I don't have the tolerance for everyone. But when I can see a part of a person, like, I could love a Jerry the way I love a Rick. Like, they're the same to me. They're both broken, lovable people. But they are broken and in a way that is hurtful and painful to everyone around them. And that's just how it goes. But they're also very lovable, and there's a reason, and people keep them around. And the reason why everyone always ends up together in the end. Because your people are your people, you know? Oh, I love it.
Not the world around him. Rick refuses...
Oh my god! Why did I do that?
Loser.
Guys, where was it?
He helps us feel better about our situations by mocking aspects of society that have let us down. Rick diminishes the value of education, personal possession.
Universe, Rick represents the death.
He helps
guys,
us feel better about
guys,
our situations by mocking.
I'm 96.
According to a 2000.
Already failed.
However, Rick makes us feel better for not having our shit together. Loser. Rick and everyone else may say he is, but they have a low threshold for what that word means, as shown by the Jerry Baree. Rick, or whatever Rick built it.
I fucked up. Oh no, this is the playground. We already watched this. Oh my god, I hate myself for doing this. Where's Doofus Rick? Here he is. We already watched this. Okay, we'll stop right here. I think this is, yeah, this is it. Okay. Oh. Wait, now I can't remember what I was gonna say. Fuck it.
On himself and blames his malaise on external factors. With that, we turn to Pickle Rick.
I'm Pickle Rick!
Pickle Rick!
The best window into this mindset. People in the fan groups love this speech.
And when I don't like something about the world, I change it. And I don't think going to a rented office in a strip mall to listen to some agent of averageness explain which words mean which feelings has ever helped anyone do anything.
Someone will post something about it way too frequently, accompanied by a comment about how badass Rick is and how stupid therapy is. They think it's a beacon of life-changing insight passed down from Dan Harmon and Justin Roiland. But if you extend the clip a little more, you get the real writer insight.
Rick, the only connection between your unquestionable intelligence and the sickness destroying your family that everyone in your family, you included, use intelligence to justify sickness. You seem to alternate between viewing your own mind as an unstoppable force and as an inescapable curse. And I think it's because the only truly unapproachable concept for you is that it's your mind within your control. The thing about repairing, maintaining, and cleaning is, it's not an adventure. There's no way to do it so wrong you might die. It's just work. And the bottom line is, some people are okay going to work, and some people, well, some people would rather die. Each of us gets to choose.
The truth is that Rick is afraid he's the one responsible for his own sadness, but can't stop himself from feeling that way. He can easily control everything in his world except for what should be the easiest thing, himself. And that stresses him out. When he tells Jerry,
that's a stupid goal that will always fail because trying it means you've already failed.
He doesn't just mean it about Jerry, he just means it. But the funny thing is that, while Rick isn't strong enough to work through his issues and find ways to manage himself, Jerry is! Which is why a large section of the show's audience dislikes Jerry. Because despite reminding them of-
Hey, do people really hate Jerry, though? I just feel like- Because I love Jerry, but like, you also- it's fun to hate Jerry.
...of their own shortcomings, Jerry isn't miserable. Like he says,
I'm easy to make happy, which is why nobody gives a shit if I am.
He faces the same problems we all do, but with vulnerability that inherently takes more-
Yeah, but Jerry's like a puppy you take care of. Doesn't that make you, like- That's- I told you, there's like a form of like a vulnerability in an adult. Because he has no reason to be. Like, Jerry isn't, there's no reason that Jerry should have to be taken care of so much. Because there's nothing holding him back except his own choices, which is why it's frustrating that he's like a child. And Morty's more of an adult than his dad is in a lot of ways. Do you know what I mean? I think that's the only part. It's just like it's frustrating to have to coddle an adult. But that's what we do for Jerry's. We love them. And even though they're adults, they're not really adults. I'm sorry. Like, you can't trust Jerry to like do certain things because he won't get it done. But for a very like almost innocent reason. But it's still really frustrating. Like, I wouldn't trust Jerry to watch my kids, but I also wouldn't trust Rick to watch my kids because they'd both neglect them. Naive, like, being naive like Jerry is a form of neglect, like being abusive like Rick is.
More work than blaming the world around you and shutting down. Instead,
Jerry takes care of himself the very, like, as well as anyone else in this house does, though.
The audience
which is not perfect. Like, it could be better and healthier.
Identifies with a cautionary tale that praises inner,
like, all of them are just surviving, none of them are living. Rick does not live, Rick survives.
Or torment, because it's easier than acknowledging you're the master of your own happiness. You just can't reach it because you're afraid. And that was my defense of Jerry. Let me know in the comments if you agree or disagree. I'm sure I'm gonna get a lot of people from both camps within this subject. Let me know what Rick and Morty characters you want me to defend in the future. I'd be happy to do it. Oh, and one more thing. So I usually wear themed shirts during my videos, and today may not seem like a-
Yet his family trusts him? Totally. Same though. I trust my family, and I think, like, Rick, like, we all trust Rick. Like, Rick's not reliable any more than Jerry is, but we trust them both to do stuff. Inner circle often can mean having people in your life that you only trust to a certain extent. My siblings and I talk about this all the time. Which one of us is most trustworthy when it comes to money, consistency, reliability? Who would take a bullet for us? Who could be there for us and, like, not crumble under the stress? We all trust people differently. And I think that's okay. I think that's the point of Rick and Morty, is that, like, you can talk about how Jerry needs to be saved from this family, or this family needs to be saved from Jerry, but they choose each other every day. And who are we to be upset with the fact that their inner circle is chaotic?